Live from Surrey Heath, the Kipper Stream.
Hello and welcome to another episode of the Kipper Stream. Today we'll be discussing the independent group and the splits within the Tory party and the Labour party and what that means for UKIP. We'll also be talking about the Brexit party amongst other things. Today I'll be joined by Sam, and we also have Jacob and Sebastian
and Gerard the giraffe.
I actually wanted to make a quick statement first. We actually have a referendum coming up in YI at the moment to do with whether we should extend the leader standing for 2 years instead of one. I was originally for 2 years for the referendum, but I was hoping to receive an assurance that we wouldn't have any early leadership elections. Unfortunately, I haven't received that that assurance, and so in this case I will be actually abstaining from the referendum vote. Do any of you guys have a position on the referendum, whether it should be 1 or 2 years?
I do.
Go ahead.
With, you know,
it'll be your best shot.
Yeah. So as with any sort of election, especially in UKIP, all positions are for 1 year terms. Now, for us to say, you know, the chairman should have a 2 year period is, I think, not right, I think, you know, with, it's like the exec, they are all have 1 year terms, and us YI chairman for regions have a 6 month period now, and for a chairman to have 2 years is, I don't think it's the right thing to do. It should be like the leader of UKIP to have a 1 year term, so it's more fairer.
Okay, well, let me just counteract you quickly. With the 2 year thing, I actually think because YI is a national organisation as opposed to a local branch, I actually think that it needs a bit more stability. And I think that because of that, I think 2 years is better because it allows for the person in charge to really get more of a foothold and get more things that they want to do done. But as I said, with the assurance for not calling an early election, the fact that we could have an early election after the referendum and have a 2 year term, because our party is going in such a transformative phase at the moment with our leadership election coming up, you know, Brexit happening, I think that it would have to be after all that. And so this is why I've made my decision as far as not actively supporting the 2 year campaign. Do you have an opinion on that? Should we go with you, Jacob?
Well, I'm backing it on the 2 year term limit. Yeah. I'm saying yes to it because I feel that YI needs its unity, its stability. And I think that if there's a 2 year term, it can provide a longer period for that. But also because I believe that with the upcoming leadership elections in UKIP, etc., we're going to need YI to stay strong and stable, if I'm to
Oh, God, he's used the word. He's used the word. We've lost now immediately.
Correction, I was never a Tory. Correct you on that. I think that, personally, I think a 2 year term limit's better than having a 1 year term limit.
Yeah, what do you think if there were to happen to be an early election after that referendum? Well, how would you feel about that?
I think with the upcoming leadership elections after the local elections, I think it just go into the chaos with that, and I think that we should hold it off until after the leadership elections personally.
It seems like most people I've spoken to at least actually agree with me on that there shouldn't be an early election. We should wait till the later in the year as it's scheduled to be. What about you, Sam? What do you think?
Well, I'm against the 2 year period. Probably one of the main reasons is that one of well, counteracts for the reason that Nate actually gave, which is the fact that other youth wings within the UK have 2 year term limits. What I say to that is, we're not Young Labour, we're not Young Conservatives, we're Young Independents. And so that's one thing. We're not them, we're us. Another thing is the fact that if it has just 1 year, that will make sure that the exec keeps on sort of, and the chairman actually makes sure that the actual people, us lot, the just normal members of YI, actually believe in what he's doing, rather than 2 years after 1 year, it can get a bit boring.
Yeah, I totally understand where you're coming from, and I'm actually quite on the fence with it, to be honest. But yeah, that's why it'll be interesting to see the course of the referendum, people's opinions coming out, etc. Anyone else want to say anything extra on that before we move on to the next topic?
No.
What cereal are you eating, by the way, Jacob?
It's not cereal, it's lasagna.
Oh, lasagna. Oh, okay. I'm so used to hearing that sound and thinking that's a cereal sound, so...
Every sound is cereal sound when you eat. Crisp or cereal?
Not really. I tend to be more careful when I eat my lasagna. I don't get too much clinkety clink.
Well, I am trying to do a podcast on it at the same time, so I have to balance responsibility.
Yeah, that's part of what you do as a great leader. Is the great leader of which region are you the leader of again? Of YI?
East Midlands.
East Midlands, that's right.
Northwest.
Northwest, yeah. And me and Sam are just the average plebiscites on the street.
I might speak to Nate to see if we can push it to Mercia.
Mercia.
To be fair, I am in favour of renaming the Midlands into Mercia, more historical roots.
Into Mercia, right, okay.
Yeah, but not everyone gonna know that it was Mercia. I didn't even know it was Mercia. So what? How do you expect a bunch of 14-year-old to? I'm part of Mercia. Well, I'm part of East Midlands. Well, that's a saying. Well,
check what? History.
Check your history. Yeah.
What's easier to say, East Midlands or Mercia?
Okay, you know what? I don't think this is a pressing issue, so how about we move on to our next topic? Okay, so the topic, as I've mentioned before, after Sebastian's finished coughing.
Sorry, went down the wrong hole.
Is the independent group, the splits between the Tory party and the Labour party, and also the Brexit party.
Oh,
could I start on this, Damien?
Yes. Okay, Jacob, what do you think about this?
So before I was a member of UKIP, I was a member of Labour.
Really?
Yeah. And there was always this divide between the Blairites and the Corbynistas. But the Blairites used to have a lot more of a hold on, but since Momentum came along, they've loosened that grip. And I think what we are seeing is the realignment of British politics on the left.
Yeah, it seems to be like this is the globalists versus the old school left wingers going at each other.
Yeah.
The free market globalists who believe in, you know, freedom of movement. Well, mind you, the old school left believe in that as well. But the idea of free markets being totally...
Especially the SDP again, isn't it?
Yeah, many people have compared it to the SDP.
Yeah. So how about I read a few little facts about this independent group? I'll move on to the fact that we've got three Tories which have joined it recently as well. So far we have 8 Labour MPs and 3 Conservative MPs. From Labour we have Chuck Amuna, Luciana Berger. I'll get to that, give me a minute. Chuck Amuna, Luciana Berger, Mike Gapes, Chris Leslie, Angela Smith, Anne Coffey, Gavin Shooker, yeah, and Joan Ryan. That's from Labour. And from the Conservatives, we have Anna Soubry, Heidi Allen, and Sarah Wollaston. I'm all right in thinking one of these MPs is actually your local MP, Sam.
They're not a local. Well, they're local, but they're not my local. My local is Diana. No, not Diana, but my local one is Nadine Dorries.
Dorries. Okay. But,
Gavin Shooker is two constituencies away. He is Luton
Gavin
South.
Shooker. Okay, it's Luton South. Okay, so what do you know about Gavin Shooker, if anything?
Basically nothing.
Okay, that's great for the stream.
Yes, I've never been good at research.
Okay, how about we go to you, Sebastian? What are you making of this?
You know, with these splits, they're always going to be a basic foundation of Labour. It's like with the Brexit Party. Nigel created this so-called party, but it still has its UKIP roots. You know, he still believes in the UKIP main policies on immigration or whatnot. And when, especially for the Brexit Party, after Brexit's done, it doesn't really have a purpose, like what people think UKIP is. That it doesn't have a purpose because we've got, well, we're getting to Brexit. And
How do you think the splits will affect UKIP? Do you think this will be a good thing for us or a bad thing?
Well, in terms of, well, I can't really comment on it really. I only have knowledge on the splits with the Brexit Party. And that's my opinion on it, really. I don't really have any sort of comment on the Labour splits.
Okay, so you don't have a an inclination that
no,
whether it might benefit.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I'll tell you my personal opinion. I actually think this is a step in the right direction. This is the beginning of a big rift within these two parties. They're actually realizing that there are powerful forces within their parties now, which they can't really do anything about, so they're naturally going to have to form their own party, which is going to be a disaster for them because I don't think they'll win their by-elections. I think UKIP will actually gain from this because we can take a lot of these voters. I think we can take a lot of these votes from the people that are disenfranchised with Labour in particular, and the Conservatives, because we've done it before. We've taken lots of Labour votes in the past before, so there's no reason why we can't do it again, I think. Who said they were from a Labour background in this chat?
I did.
You did? Okay. So do you have any insights into Labour that you could tell us about and, you know, what might be happening at this moment?
So I presume all the Corbyn supporters are going into a bit of a meltdown right now.
Yeah.
I presume they're all going to be like trying to trigger as many recalls into their MPs as possible that are Blairite. I mean, I saw a Daily Mail article that one of my local MPs, Margaret Beckett, she's going to be challenged for her seat by a pro Corbyn supporter.
Mm.
And this is just really re-kicked the momentum machine to get these people deselected before they can drift off into this independent group.
So, do you think they'll form like a new party with a official structure and everything else?
Without a doubt, that's obviously what Chukwuemeka was looking towards in his speech on the news. But
so, who's going to be the one to lead this party, do you think? He's the natural.
It's got to be Chukwuemeka. It's either Chukwuemeka or Anna Soubry, because they're both ex Remainers.
I don't think Anna Soubry will. She's not a fan. I think it's going to be one of the founding seven, and I definitely agree that Chuka will be one. I think Gavin is another one. Do I think what's her name? The young woman in there,
Luciana Berger.
Yeah, that's it. I think she's probably the other choice. So those three are the big ones in there. They're the most vocal.
Yeah. Well, Jeremy Corbyn has actually said, Jeremy Corbyn has said the Labour MPs who have quit the party should resign and put themselves up for election. None of them have put themselves up for a by-election so far, which is kind of interesting, which is coming from people who say, oh, we want to give the people a choice and everything. I don't think we want to be giving them that choice.
I'll tell you what I find funny, that's party that's being formed. And that is that they're all ARC Remainers.
It seems to me like they're trying to make like the globalist party, essentially.
Like I said in a chat on YI Hub that they should regenerate Tony Blair and make him leader.
Yeah.
Yeah, but what? Didn't you hear they're going to get in J.K. Rowling?
That's what I was thinking, because I read that article, and does that mean they're going to link up, or is that just talk?
I think that's just speculation. I don't think that's actual thing. But if it did, imagine the motto, Electus Patronum.
I was actually really saddened by that news, because I'm actually a big fan of Rachel Riley.
She's
a fantastic TV presenter. The way she presents herself is very, very nice, I think.
Damien fancies her.
Damien fancies me, so we can't do that.
Yeah.
I thought we were married.
You know, that's always the case, you know. You know, the ones you like, they always end up being bloody globalists.
No, I'm not a globalist, so...
But I'm a heterosexual. Did you not see my YI poster?
Well, we're getting married tomorrow, don't you know that? You was there, like, booking it with me.
Look, can we talk more about this independent group, please?
I think...
You know what? I should have done more research on this, but I couldn't be bothered.
Can I ask you guys something?
Mm-hmm.
Go on.
What are the odds this party is being funded by George Soros?
I actually don't think I would go down that road of thinking that, to be honest. I think
George Soros would go for the Lib Dems. That's
a bit riskier, isn't it?
I don't know. I can't see George Soros doing something like this. I know he does a lot of dodgy stuff with like funding these groups to persuade immigrants to get visas and all that kind of stuff, but I can't see him funding this particular group for some reason. That's another thing that the left always like to say about right wingers. We like to accuse everyone of being George Soros funded.
it's a meme.
Guilty.
In fact, it says on this piece here, let me say, it says, who funds them here? On their website, the group of MPs say they are supported by a company called Gemini A Limited, which was set up last month by Labour defector Mr. Shooker, who lives near Sam.
That's one of the reasons why I think he could be the leader. See, he is putting a lot of money into it.
Oh, okay. Have you heard of the company Gemini?
Right, what?
Have you heard of his company, Gemini A? Is this some weird company that he's just set up or something?
Yeah, I think it's just set up purely to fund the independent group.
Right, okay. And it says here that, they've been crowdfunding via their website. So they're not a registered political party yet.
Unpronounceable name... he has said that he wants it to become a political party.
Mike Gapes, Chris Leslie, Gavin Shooker. No, okay, I don't know.
I can
Chuck Romana.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah, okay. Right, well, yeah, it's an interesting one. Will there be by-elections, do you think?
God, no, there won't be. They wouldn't dream of it because they know they'll lose the seats.
Yeah. So,
I will actually add that Gavin Shooker in Luton South actually has quite a lot of support. So it is possible he could win a by-election if one is held there.
Right.
But it is also very Labour, so...
Mm. So will, is there a chance we might get an early general election, do you think?
If we extend Article 50, that's more than likely going to be a general election.
Agreed. Yeah.
But, yeah. But it won't be caused because of the split necessarily.
No.
Yeah, okay. So, yeah, I guess it's more of a case that, you know, this is just fun to watch more than anything. Maybe it's probably not going to be like a big political shift, but it just shows you the natural splits which are happening, because the way our politics has been for quite a while now, it hasn't been very representative of the people. So I think this is like a natural balancing which is happening right now.
I mean, I wrote an article on this about Labour for Kipper Central.
Mm.
And I think I'd encourage our viewers to go look at that article, because I give it a bit more of an insight onto the schisms in the Labour Party.
Mm.
So, that's to go look at if you want more information.
Well, the natural benefit of this is splitting the Labour vote, I think. So that's going to reduce their chances of getting elected. So that can only be a good thing.
There is one thing I do have a problem with if there is a by-election or an early general election called, and that is the split or debate between For Britain and UKIP and all these smaller
parties. For Britain are so tiny, I honestly don't think they'll ever make an indent politically. But yeah, the good thing is that it will split the Labour vote, I think. So that'll stop them from getting elected. But for the Conservatives, is this going to damage the Conservative Party, as people like me really want it to?
I think it'll damage Labour more, to be honest.
Yeah. So go on, Sebastian.
You believe, say, you know, if Labour gets a new vote, new leader, because this is all down to, you know, Jeremy Corbyn, do you think they will run back to Labour once they get a sort of a new party leader? Same with Conservatives.
Yeah. Well, in Labour's case, I actually think that Corbyn actually has a really big stronghold now. I was listening to Michael Portillo on this week. And he was saying, no, sorry, this was a guest on this week, and he was saying how this is different to even what happened in the 80s, I think, with Michael Foot and stuff, where they've actually got all the keys to the castle now. Like, they control a hell of a lot of Labour now, to a point where it's really difficult to topple Corbyn. Look how hard they've tried, and they've realised they can't now, so they have to split.
I'll tell you who to look out for on the Labour side.
Mm.
And that's Chris Williamson, the MP for Derby North.
Right. Okay, why is that?
He's a very vocal supporter of Jeremy Corbyn, and he has a lot of base in the Corbyn camp. So if Corbyn got
shifted,
voted down by his own base,
yeah,
I could see Williamson and rising up to take that base over if Corbyn.
That's interesting. Is he a Marxist like Corbyn is, I'm guessing?
Well, at the Momentum conference, he called himself a Marxist Republican.
A Marxist Republican. Okay, so it's not enough having Marxism. He wants to get rid of the Queen as well.
That's cool. Yes, but also Chris Williamson last year, he did a tour of the UK with a few of his Labour pals. That's like sort of a bit like what you do in a presidential election. I have the exploratory committee. It was kind of similar to that. What Chris Williamson did for his supposed leadership bid.
Right, okay.
So yeah. I just think you should keep an eye on him.
Yeah, the only way I see Labour changing leaders ever is them having a general election and Corbyn just getting mullered in the election. That's the only way I see...
Or Corbyn dying. That could be another option.
Or Corbyn dying, but...
I'm just going to say I don't condone any assassinations.
I'm not sure if I believe you with the way you said that. You need to sound a bit more sincere, I think.
I don't support people assassinating people. That's evil. If you do it...
Why are you smiling? Why are you smiling?
You're just going to make me smile now more.
I might have to cut that bit out just in case The Guardian put it up. Okay. All right. Let's move on then. So What do we make of the Brexit Party then? Nigel Farage, our old buddy until he decided to betray us.
It's a hate relationship with Farage, isn't it?
Yeah, he's done so much good for us, but the way he is acting now, calling us racist and whatnot.
I think I know this might sound a bit harsh for you guys to hear, because I know you all love Nigel, but I think he's been brought by this.
I don't like him.
I used to like him, but now I don't. I think he's just throwing a childish tantrum.
I think he's been bought by the establishment.
Oh yeah,
I'm with Seb on that.
Sorry, what did you say, Seb?
What about him being basically because his vision of UKIP isn't being followed? He's throwing a childish tantrum to be like, "No, I want UKIP this way," kind of thing. That's
the whole
of it, because you know. We all know he doesn't like Gerard Batten's vision of the party because of what he says about Islam, but that's not Gerard's fault. You know, it keeps getting brought up in interviews when they say, right, we want you on for Brexit, but then they talk about Islam. Now, that's not Gerard's fault. He can only answer what he's asked by the presenter. So Nigel making all these comments here, oh, it's now an anti-Islam party. Well, no, we're not. You know, we think that, yeah, Islam does have some dodgy bits, but that doesn't mean we...
A lot of dodgy bits.
But that doesn't mean we hate Islam. You know, there may be some people who do, but that doesn't mean that everyone is, you know, anti-Islam. It's like with racism. Yeah, we had members who have been racist, but that doesn't make us all racist, though, does it?
Well, I would say that I do hate Islam, but I don't hate Muslims, and that is obviously a big difference.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Mm. But it's like what I said with racism. We've had a number of racists in our party. Thank God they're gone. But that doesn't mean we're all racist, and people made that assumption, like Nigel is doing.
Yeah, what I find really hypocritical about Nigel is he's saying, you know, UKIP has gone down this far right direction, blah, 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 and that all we talk about is Islam and that kind of stuff now, which is total rubbish. We believe in so many different things. We talk about different things. Gerard talks about different things all the time. But exactly the same thing used to happen to Farage. They'd say to Farage, all you ever talk about is immigration and, you know, hating immigrants, and he would obviously say, no, actually, I have opinions on all sorts of things, but all you ever want to talk to me about is immigration.
Yeah.
And now he's accusing UKIP of the same thing. It's like, how hypocritical can you get?
I believe once we get through Brexit, he'll be running back to us in no time, because...
But we'll be taken back, though.
Well, you know, he will be running back because he wants to be an MEP. Well, he wants to be in the public. He wants all the cameras on
attention.
Yeah, and why should he have that when he basically called us all chavs, skinheads, and whatnot? I'm not a chav, and I'm sure Damien isn't a chav. He's the most poshest person going.
Yeah, most poshest working class person out there.
But you know, once we get through Brexit, I believe that the Brexit Party members will come running to UKIP. I can just see it, because they have nowhere else to turn.
Yeah, I agree. And they've only actually signed up for European elections, which may not even happen. They haven't signed up for the local elections, and I don't think who's to know whether they will sign up for a general election as well. So at the moment, we're not even talking about like a real party. This is just like a reactionary protest.
It's just a fraud squad, isn't it?
Exactly, yeah.
If we do have a general election and this so-called Brexit party still in action, once we've left, I don't think it'll be... there's a possibility of being extended, but I very highly doubt... Well, there might be a possibility, but I don't think it will. But how can they sign up to a general election being the Brexit party when we've gone through Brexit? I'm going to have to come up with a new name, like an anti-illegal immigrant party or
catchy. You know,
or the Trump Party in UK, well, Trump Party UK or Republicans UK.
Or let's build a wall UK, or let's stop foreign nationals taking our benefits UK party.
Well, yeah. Well, we stand on a lot of things other than just those issues. But yeah, I know what you're getting at.
I will say from the entire thing, I actually think in the long run, this is going to be both advantageous to both UKIP and the new Brexit party, because the people that have left and the people who are still here, they do tend to be two different types of people. And those people are people who would generally vote for two different parties that aren't us two, that being Labour and the Tories, with us being more Labour and them being more Tory. So with people, more and more people, well, trusting both Labour and the Tories left, it's quite possible that both our parties will actually replace those two.
Yeah, that is true, because I see the Brexit Party as being the party full of a lot of people who go, oh, you know what, that UKIP party, I'd never vote for them because they're the racist party and all this rubbish. The type of, to me, this is, well, I know I go on about too much about class, but this is to me like a middle class thing where I go, oh, UKIP, bloody racists, whilst I think the type of people
that sounded very upper class, Damien.
Yeah. But the type of people that would vote UKIP, I think, are coming from a slightly different place. Like you say, I think these are more the average working people, working class people. So, yeah, you're right. This could be beneficial for both the Brexit Party and UKIP, funnily enough, even though it doesn't seem like it possibly could. But that could be the case.
Mm-hmm.
I do think this is, a partly a vanity thing on Farage as well. You can't help but think that since he has had his LBC show and everything like that, he's become very accustomed to the limelight and everything that comes with it.
Yeah, he just wants all that attention, because with UKIP, he did get all that attention. And I think partly the reason is he started this LBC show because we're not interested in him anymore. He's not interested in us. So we need another way to find a way to be in that limelight. And that's the only way. So he's just trying to get the fame, if you will.
Yeah, but I think Farage was not actually ever that loyal to UKIP. I think he saw UKIP as more of a vehicle to things he wanted to achieve.
Well, it's like when, you know, when we had that financial situation in February, well, you know, before February, you know, he had that chance to come back and save UKIP.
He had that chance,
but he didn't come back. So that kind of showed to me that when he was leader and when he stepped down, he had no intention of coming back. He had no intention. It was just like, I'm not leader anymore. I don't care what happened with UKIP. I've done what I need to do, so bye. And you can struggle on your own. That was my impression.
Well, it definitely does seem to me that Nigel, he's not stupid. That's quite obvious. So if he generally did... I don't think it's a fame thing. I think it is more his morals, because I think he is much more... of a Tory than a Kipper. So with us going down the route, he didn't agree with it, so he left. If he just wanted fame, he would have stayed with us, and he quite well, as you would say, he would have not resigned in 2016. He would have stood for the election that ensued after he stepped down, and that his follow-up stepped down. I think that happened. I might be making it up. And then after, when Paul Nuttall stepped down, he would have stood then if he generally did want the fame.
The reason why I think partly it might be a bit of fame is because I think he doesn't actually disagree with us on most of the issues, especially the more controversial ones such as Islam. I think it's more the case that He believes in a slightly different method, and he thinks he's going to be able to appeal to voters more by
I think Farage is more old school politics, isn't he?
What's that?
Depends what you mean by old school.
Like, he's more of like going door to door and knocking on doors, talking to people, whereas Gerard's more like social media based and a bit more.
I wouldn't say that. I would just say he's more concerned with the optics and things like that. And he has a certain image which he wants to have. And UKIP doesn't provide that image for him anymore. So he's moved on. But yeah, I don't think this will be massively damaging to UKIP. I think it will damage us a little bit because I think we will drain some votes from it. But I don't think it'll be massive. So that's my opinion.
I think if Nigel had the chance, you know, when Gerard steps down or whatever, if we do, you know, continue getting talked about Islam, I think he will jump back in and try to say, look, we're taking the party in a totally different direction and standing again and there's nothing you can do about it kind of thing. And I want to see UKIP back in its original formality. I think if he did have a chance, he would take it no matter what. No doubts about it.
It is possible. I personally don't see it happening, but I guess it's all, anything is possible at the moment. But yeah, that's my conclusion from the whole splits and the Brexit Party. I think the Brexit Party will damage us a little bit. I think the Labour and the Tory splits will actually be beneficial to us a little bit, but I don't think either things are going to be massively beneficial or massively bad for us in the long run. I think our main focus needs to just keep doing what we're doing, ploughing ahead, get Gerard in the mainstream, get him in the public debate and everything, and naturally grow like that.
Do you think... go on, Jacob.
I think what we need to do as a party is be seen as the party of unity and just be seen as the party of unity. Because if Conservatives and Labour continue to be splitting, what we should do is just be like, right, look at these parties. They're not doing anything right now because of the split. And we just get into the public's mindset of us being the party of unity that can take Britain forward. And if I think we can do that, we can just take a lot of these marginal seats and just be like, there's nothing you can do to stop us now because we're in the public mindset and we've got this brand of being the party of unity and nationalism, and we can just take that message to the country, and I think we'd get a really good response with it.
Yeah, and I think not being afraid to talk bluntly about things like Islam and immigration, and that will resonate with a lot of people because a lot of people are sick of political correctness and sick of having to accept the status quo when it comes to...
In terms of my situation at uni, just today, I've got over, 100 messages saying how they are sick of not being able to say certain things because it offends people. And that shows to me that we're now living in a society where people know it's going on. You know, there's no doubt about that. Even the younger generation can see it, I personally think. But with all the support that I'm getting, it does show that political correctness is going too far. And, you know, political correctness, we need to kind of like bash it out and say, look, you know, you can say these things. You know, there's going to be obviously limitations. You know, if it's hateful, you know, racial hatred and stuff like that, that's when it stops. But, you know, you criticising something doesn't mean that you are sort of against it, if you know what I mean. Not against it, but you don't fully dismiss the idea of it being there. You just want to criticise it. And that's what we need to get into the people's heads. And I think only you could do that.
Seb, could I just comment on your university situation?
You can try.
Well, I think with what's happening in education and universities and stuff like that is very enrooted in left-wing worldview.
Yes.
Because what they're trying to do is, have you ever heard of the term intersectionality?
No.
You've not heard about intersectionality?
No.
Yeah. I think what they're trying to do is trying to divide and conquer certain groups and profiles and make it so we all have to stick to those stereotypes.
Yeah.
And it makes the population easier to control through stereotyping and stuff like that. And it just makes it, and it just makes up like a certain section of society to another sector. And that's where the term intersectionality comes from. I think I'm right, aren't I, Damien?
Sorry, I was reading something at the same time. Intersectionality to me is basing groups on their characteristics, such as...
Yeah, that's what I just said. It's about making people into a one sect and then putting other people in another sect and making them fight over nothing, basically.
Yeah. I'd agree with that.
Exactly,
well,
yeah.
In regard to my university, I do have another update as well. If you want to hear it.
Oh, go on, please. Give us an exclusive.
So, obviously, like I said in the last stream, that I wasn't going to appeal because, obviously, I wasn't going to get a fair trial because, you know, leftists, you know, once they think something, you can't change their minds. Once they call you a racist, you are a racist. Apparently so. However, I've been speaking to the party barrister and he says we need to appeal it because obviously in law, before you take someone to court, you have to exercise every possible route in order to remedy the situation or trying to fix the outcome. So with that in mind, I've decided to appeal it. Now, obviously, we all know what's going to happen. It's still going to be the same situation. And, yeah, it's going to be appealed. I'm still waiting on a new date. It's going to be with a new panel, so I do get a fair hearing. And after they come up with the same outcome, then, obviously, we'll proceed with the judicial review in court.
Right, okay. So things are moving a bit faster now.
Oh, yeah, definitely.
Yeah. I was just trying to find an article, actually, because I was doing some research for my Kipper Central article about Hope Not Hate's statistics for a third of Britons thinking Islam is a threat to British culture.
Was that on that Sky News report the other day?
Probably, yeah. But I was just trying to find a figure because I thought it was quite interesting that apparently in their poll, in their poll, apparently 52% or something like that of people in Britain know who Tommy Robinson is. I thought it was quite interesting.
Well, my friend doesn't know who Tommy Robinson is. I was like, you're mad. He's on TV like every single day.
But that's the thing, like what we're talking about with free speech and all that kind of stuff and Islam and immigration. UKIP needs to be a mouthpiece for that. And I think people like Tommy Robinson certainly help that. But that was last episode. Let's not dwell on that stuff too much.
On the Sky News report, that Hope Not Hate report, they used footage of the Tommy Robinson rally as a part of the far-right commentary.
Right.
Well, when I was at that Brexit march, funnily enough, this Pakistani Muslim, he was a reporter, said this is a far-right movement. And I was like, what? I'm not far-right? How dare you?
That's bigoted.
Yeah, exactly. And I was just like, you don't even know what far-right is, mate. You know, far-right are those who believe... who are so keen on keeping, you know, the white generation going rather than having foreign nationals break that up. And I was just like, how dare you, kind of thing.
You showed them, Sebastian.
Well, I wish I could stand something, but the crowd was moving, so I had to move along as well. But yeah, it was fun.
Okay, so how about we move on to our next topic then, after Jacob's finished doing his headphones.
Sorry, just get a bit uncomfortable.
That's okay. So I thought next we'd talk about Bernie Sanders going up for election.
I don't know about the situation, so you can...
I'm not sure he's going to be alive in time to actually see the end of his term. Although he's 77, which now is quite young, he looked like he's in his 90s.
I think what's going to happen with Bernie is Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren on a ticket together.
I don't think so, actually, because I'm not sure if they're quite as compatible as you think.
I think it'll be Bernie and Ocasio-Cortez.
That's very possible. There's also another person I was listening to on the Spectator podcast who I'd never heard of before.
Tulsi, that woman.
No, it's a man. I've forgotten his name, though. But
the guy you dropped out.
He's apparently more of a Bernie guy.
I know who that, but I can't remember his name.
Yeah, well, that's no good. But so do you think Bernie versus Trump, he will have more of a chance than Trump versus Hillary?
Oh, God, yeah.
I think he will definitely have more of a chance. I've heard many people say that he'll win in this country. However, from talking to people from America, I think Trump's going to win.
I think it depends on the optics of the election.
Well, we'll talk about this election. What about Kanye West in 2020?
Well, he very much supports Trump, so I actually don't think he'll run against him.
Yeah, I think he said so as well, actually.
As VP.
I don't think Kanye has a chance anyway.
Kanye West as VP, did you say?
Yeah, why not?
That would be a good look.
I think Pence has done well enough job that I don't think...
You could have the White House or the Observatory where the VP stays.
Well, the thing about Bernie is, which Trump might be slightly worried about, is apparently he's quite good at picking up the lower middle class, working class votes in places like West Virginia, places like that.
But
because apparently they voted quite heavily for him in the primaries for the Democrats. Sorry,
it's very left. Go ahead.
I started singing Country Roads. Yeah.
I think the states you mentioned, Damien, are very centre left, so they're probably going to go for the Democratic nominee more than the Republican nominee in terms of middle class to lower middle class.
Like these states, like West Virginia, but also like the Midwest states. Apparently, Bernie does quite well.
West Virginia.
I know Alabama has a song, but I've never heard West Virginia. That song.
Alabama. Take me home.
I can't sing. What about Georgia? Georgia? On my mind.
Oh, well, in terms of the word Georgia, I was on a camp once. We were in the army cadets, right? And we had a lad, a male cadet. And at night, you could hear him saying, "Oh, Georgia, Georgia, ah." Kind of thing, so we just pissed them off every single time. So whenever
he's singing the Georgia song,
no, it was just like saying, "Oh, Georgia." So then we was like, "Oh, Georgia, Georgia, ah," and he got incredibly pissed off and he quit cadets because of it.
Oh, that's a shame. I'm sure he would have made a fantastic fighting warrior.
So they were bullying.
I'm a bit disappointed in you lot, actually. I thought you'd be more up to date with your US politics, but I guess that's more just me then.
Well, there's quite a lot happening in British politics, and we are British.
That is true. But I do feel like we're part of like a pan Atlantic movement right now with Trump and Brexit. I feel like we have a lot in common.
We are in a movement, but for us at the moment, it's way more important we focus on just here and then. So we've done a bit. Probably next year we can focus on helping other parties.
And then we can go over to America and campaign for Trump 2020.
We need build a wall, and it has to be done quickly.
We don't have that problem because we have a big moat around our country, luckily.
We could try and organise a YI trip to the States. 2020.
Well, if anyone wants to fund that, I'll happily get on board with that.
Yourself, I think. And get permission off the Bulldog Baton.
Bulldog Baton, yeah.
I think Baton would be up for it and probably fund it.
Or you could ask Gerard the Giraffe. He might fund it.
Yeah, do you want to tell us about Gerard the Giraffe, then?
Yeah, so Gerard the Giraffe, he arrived today. He's originally called Danny the Daddy Giraffe, but I've decided he deserves a more beloved name, so I decided to name him after Gerard Batten, our beloved leader. He's a devoted member of UKIP, and he supports UKIP. He hasn't told anyone to fuck off yet, but it's still time. I'm just hoping that he doesn't piss on the floor. Is that right, Mr. Gerard? Yes, it is.
This is meant to be a serious stream.
Gerard, this is serious, aren't you?
We're UKIP, of course, it's not going to be a serious stream.
That was actually a good line.
Sargon
said at the Worcester conference, he was wearing he wasn't wearing a suit, and I think he said something. I would have wore a suit if UKIP was a serious, if I was a serious person, and UKIP was a serious party.
Has anyone noticed my mystery sauce?
Yes.
Oh, you've replaced a ketchup, you traitor!
Now mayo.
Mayonnaise.
What's next topic?
Okay, here's a good question. Chips, mayonnaise or ketchup?
Ketchup.
Mayonnaise.
You slag.
I don't know what it is. There's something about ketchup and mayonnaise. They just go really well together.
Oh, what about burger sauce? Oh my God, that to die for.
Oh, that is just disgusting.
But it depends what burger sauce. Some of them are disgusting. Some of them are really, really nice.
Depends if it's coming from a dirty old kebab van or, I don't know, some fancy restaurant.
Ketchup, mayonnaise, and a bit of mustard. To die for.
Mustard, I think, only really works with hot dogs.
Well, you would know, wouldn't you?
Why is that? What's that an insult to?
I forgot what the word is. I don't know what the word is.
Yeah, you being classist or Lutonianist or what?
Lutonianist, great.
Yeah.
I'm working class. I don't know what that word means.
I don't even think Northerners have a class. I think they're just Northern. That's it.
Weird people.
That's racist.
There's no such thing as a posh Northerner.
Well, I'd have to agree with you on that. You know, especially with people from Birmingham. You're right, mate.
That was a terrible Birmingham accent.
Or people from Yorkshire, eh?
Try do a Surrey accent. Let's hear that.
I don't know what Surrey people
say. I'll say something and you try and sound like me.
Hey, lad.
All right, my name's Damien. How you doing? I like to have mayonnaise with my chips. Go on, say that.
So basically, you want me to talk posh?
Oh, a Surrey accent, whatever you want to call it.
I speak with quite a posh Lutonian accent.
I do understand that, yes.
I mean, it's not posh, but I'm very well spoken for locals.
It's not
posh. As shown by Tommy Robinson.
It's not posh. Posh.
Do you know who really digs English accents and not Americans, as most people say?
American.
Oh, great answer. No. Latin chicks, for some reason, they seem to really dig the English accent. I've been to Barcelona.
About 10 English accents, so which one does she mean?
No, but whenever foreign people think of the English accent, they obviously think of the more like southern BBC type accent, don't they? Kind of like me, you know.
Badoodly doo.
But I just remember being in Barcelona, and there were these couple girls from Argentina, and they were like, "Oh, can you please say water? We love the way you say water."
Here's a question for you guys. Did you see that video, that tweet that Katie Hopkins tweeted out asking for an electoral pact between UKIP for Britain and the Brexit party?
Yes, I did.
Really?
I've not seen it.
In what way would this pact occur?
Just that, because of like how crap everything's going, she just basically said, you guys need to sit down and talk together and kind of unite.
Basically, we wouldn't stand in each other's seats. Is that basically what the pact would entail?
Basically, yeah, I think.
Right.
I think for Brexit, yes. However, there's just a general election. I would say for Britain, maybe. However, the Brexit Party, no.
No,
I agree with that.
Yeah, I agree with that. Although, to be honest, I wouldn't really care for having a pact with for Britain, because to me, they're such a tiny, insignificant party. I actually really do like AMD, Anne-Marie Waters, but I don't think it's...
Do you know who the iconoclast is on YouTube?
Yeah, is he the Irish guy?
No, that's Computing Forever. The iconoclast, he's a Brit. He's done a video which I very much think that he's trying to promote for Britain, and he is quite popular, so... From that, they could gain some members.
Well, we've got Count Dankula, we've got Paul Joseph Watson, we've got
PJW, my hero.
And then there's Milo Yiannopoulos, who hasn't been sort of active anywhere for about a year.
Yeah, but didn't he join UKIP?
Yeah, he is a member.
UKIP, yeah.
So what's happened with Milo? Wasn't he going through that legal battle?
I think he's still doing loads of stuff in America. He's not going to think about doing stuff here. Possibly if he comes back, but, you know, I don't see that happening. Mm. But yeah, Sargon's doing some great stuff with UKIP at the moment. Did you see the video with The Economist?
Tall speech.
The Economist guy.
No.
Oh, he was just talking about the EU and everything, and how, well, basically saying most of what we already know, how it's a disaster and how we need to, like, expand our markets where the economies are actually growing and not...
Oh, I think I saw stagnant. That.
Yeah. It was really good.
Interesting, yeah.
Well, Sargon of Akkad is relaunching the UKIP YouTube channel.
He's part of the relaunch.
Yeah.
That's definitely good. I hope both Paul Joseph Watson and Count Dankula will be on it, because those two are quite funny and will help get in the humour.
That's the last thing I saw about Sargon of Akkad. I was reading it yesterday, and he's going to be part of EE Think6, you know, to reach out to younger members. Why not relaunch it? Instead of posting videos about, you know...
A random speech in Scunthorpe or something.
He could actually sit down there and talk in the modern youth language.
So is he going to be essentially controlling the YouTube channel then?
I think so, yeah.
That's fantastic.
There is one person we need to recruit to the party.
Who?
Ali G.
No, PewDiePie.
Have you not seen Ali G with Jacob Rees-Mogg?
Yes, I have.
Oh, that is fantastic.
If you bang me sister, does that make me sister upper class?
Yeah. Oh, what about where he goes, what class are packies?
He is so not politically correct.
Yeah. Although I don't think he'd say that now, mind you.
No, I could just imagine Paul Joseph Watson on the UKIP channel. Well, I'm a Sebria. I quit the Conservative Party. Well, imagine my shock.
Yeah. I should be doing that, because I'm the one who looks like him. Imagine my shock.
How long have we been on for now?
I think we've been on for just over an hour or something. Yeah. No, we will wrap it up soon, because I don't want to go on ages like we did last time. But we were enthusiastic that day.
Yeah,
that's really great news about the YouTube channel, though.
Oh, yeah,
I'd love to see like all of them jump on that and make it like a really vibrant channel.
A lot of people still think UKIP is a part of the old people, but if we get people like Paul Joseph Watson and that on this YouTube channel, then they will be informed and it's not an old whole people party.
I think that dynamic's going to change at the local elections, that we're a party of old people.
Oh, yeah. Do you think we'll actually gain some seats in this election now?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. I think we'll gain a good 200, hopefully.
I don't think that many.
Oh, parliamentary seats? No, we won't get anything near 200.
Local elections.
Oh, yeah, no. We will get quite a lot of seats. Yeah.
If we do have a general election this year, do you think we'll get any seats in Parliament?
I think we will get a few seats.
I think we'll get one.
Yeah.
There was actually a projection, I think, that we'd get like 2, 3, 4 or something. I can't remember what the projection was.
I swear there was one that said Thoric would switch to us.
Right, that would be good. Yeah. What's happening with the Peterborough thing as well? Is that woman going to finally step down or not?
I've got that's my region, not constituency. But hopefully Ben will, if that does happen, there will be an action day there, which I will try my best to attend. So
it's down the road from me, pretty much.
But she could just stay on because you can't
She could, but the petition is huge to get her off. People don't like her anymore.
In fact, I think there is a rule where you can't be removed from Parliament unless it's over a year's sentence. And I think she's had less than a year.
Yeah, it's less than a year.
There is a clause where if you get a certain amount of signatures to a petition from that constituency, if it's past a certain threshold, then she has to stand down. So I don't know how close they are to that, but if they can get it past that threshold, that'd be fantastic.
Like 10,000 signatures or something like that.
But it might be 10,000, yeah.
Because I know that's, you know, I do think that might be I think that might be regions, but if it's something national, then it needs to be like over 100,000, something like that. But I think it might be 10,000, I'm not sure.
It won't be 100,000 because that's way too high. There's not even that amount of people in per constituency, I don't think. But, yeah, I really would love to see that by-election. I think UKIP could do well. We have a fantastic candidate. The reason I know he's a fantastic candidate is because he wears an eye patch. You know, what candidate who wears an eye patch is not going to be one of the best candidates ever?
Mr. Blobby.
Pugsy.
Pugsy, yeah.
The Monster Waving Loony Party candidates, just all of them.
They wear eye patches?
No, they don't wear eye patches, but that they always make themselves look stupid. I mean, there's Lord Buckethead, who's a knight. So,
anyway, I'm hoping towards that by-election we see plenty of pirate-themed memes and political memes on that. That'll be good to see. So, Jake, I want to see you get involved in that. You know which Jake I'm talking about. Okay, so anything else we want to talk about before we put the stream to a close?
I have a new business.
Go on, what's your new business?
Proposed to Gerard. I call it, right, get this, Sebastian Walsh's EU flag renewal.
Okay, I'm going to finish the stream.
You know, my typical flag removal rate is 2 flags per night. Pretty good at the minute.
For anyone who doesn't know what Sebastian's talking about, on the Bolton event for UKIP, he pulled down a few EU flags. I've been told
EU flags.
2 EU flags. Yeah. Yeah, so, it could be a future business, I guess.
Well, if you want an EU flag removing within your area, please do feel free to contact me and I'll do my best to try and remove it, because you don't want a a piece of shit hanging from the lamppost.
We have a EU flag up in one of my college rooms, and so I might inquire into your services, Sebastian.
Okay. Well, I'll give you mate rates, but the school might have to pay me because I don't do this shit for free. And okay. Then I'm planning, right, to go over to the place where the EU hangs out, Belgium, or wherever, Brussels.
I can confirm Brussels is in Belgium.
Well, I want to remove their EU flag and then take ours down while I'm at it.
Put a Union Jack up there to say we've conquered them.
No. Out of curiosity, if Brussels is in Belgium, where are Sprouts?
Okay, we're definitely closing the stream now. So this has been a great stream. We will see you on the next edition of the Kipper Stream.
You need to get the loose woman theme tune playing when you say that.
Loose Kippers.
Loose Kippers. We are known as the Loose Kippers, but I still think our name should be the Kipper Stream. It just has more of a, you know, I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
Anyway. Bye. Good night, everyone.
Good night, babe. Love you.
Morning.